This hulking beast is just a piece of the TC-497, and it was far, far ahead of its time. Over 25 feet tall, nearly 600 feet long back in the day, with a gas turbine hybrid powertrain, hub-mounted motors, 54-wheel drive, and computer-controlled steering. All impressive enough by today's standards. But this thing was built over a half century ago. So what is it exactly? You're looking at an experimental overland train made for the US Army in an attempt to build the future of cargo transportation in a very mid-century America kind of way. It was actually one of four created by its genius inventor, each fully functional and more fantastical than the last. That future was never realized. But the reason why you might have never heard about them before is as simple as these machines were complex. Let me tell you the story of Robert Gilmore LeTourneau and his attempts to build the ultimate heavy transportation vehicle, the overland train. So in 1954, the Cold War was in full swing, and with the threat of Soviet bombers pouring over the North Pole ever more present, both the US and Canada agreed that they needed some kind of warning system. Remember, back then all we had was radar, and radar has its limits. Namely, it can't see very far, a few hundred miles at most for a ground station. The US needed more time than that to get its defenses ready. So why not build a bunch of them just as far north as possible? Well, just like that, the distant early warning line was born. The plan was to set up a string of 63 radar stations above the Arctic Circle, basically as close to Russia's population centers as you can get in North America. From early 1955, as locations were scouted and the planning stage was wrapping up, the US and Canadian government set a target date of July 1957 to have the dew line up and running, which was a little more than 2 years out. The problem with the dew line is that it's, you know, above the Arctic Circle. Epically harsh winters, no established infrastructure, no obvious way to get thousands of workers and tens of thousands of tons of materials and equipment up there to build the outposts, let alone keep them running. With barges limited to use in the short summer months, planes limited by the lack of suitable runways, and heavy lift helicopters still in their infancy, the US Army Transportation Research and Development Command, or TRADCOM, set about finding a new solution to long-haul off-road logistics. And they knew just the man to call. Pretty much all you need to know about inventor and engineer R.G. LeTourneau is summed up in a quote from his 1960 autobiography, R.G. LeTourneau, Mover of Men and Mountains. In it, he describes a machine he designed to cut supply lines through dense jungles in South America, which he affectionately called the Jungle Crusher, having trouble crushing some particularly large trees. Quote, "When confronted with a situation like that, established thinking would have you believe the trees are too big. My own thinking was that the machines were too small, and once the problem becomes as simple as that, you build a bigger machine." Born in 1888, LeTourneau was a mechanical genius who eventually started a company called LeTourneau Technologies that became known as the primary developer of earthmoving machines and other large construction vehicles in the pre-war era. In fact, the company supplied nearly 70% of all earthmoving equipment used by the Allies in World War II. And when TRADCOM came knocking, he was working on a new technology he was convinced could change the world. That technology was a hybrid powertrain, but not the kind you're thinking of. LeTourneau was obsessed with the idea of taking a diesel-electric system used in locomotives, where a diesel engine powers a generator that in turn runs electric motors, which in turn powers wheels, and putting it in a road vehicle. Taking it further, he was convinced that hub motors would be perfect as they'd reduce drivetrain losses to almost zero. With no extra components between the motor and the wheel, the power on the box was the power you get. And with hub motors, you could have as many drive wheels as you wanted, even on trailers.
Now there's an idea.
And the timing was perfect. In 1953, just 1 year before the dew line was proposed, LeTourneau had sold the earthmoving portion of his business to Westinghouse and put all his diesel-electric ideas into the very first overland train prototype, the VC-12. The VC was a squat, wide control car and trailers designed for logging operations. Each hub-mounted motor had its own inboard braking system and a reduction gear to multiply the torque, increasing the power at the wheels. Not only did this increase wheel torque, but the setup also increased ground clearance and protected critical components. It's actually kind of similar to the braking and portal axle setup of the modern Humvee. The only difference is that the Humvee's mechanical drivetrain turns all four wheels, while LeTourneau's VC12 had that divorced electric drivetrain. This meant that if he added the same hub-mounted motors to each of his trailers, they would only need a power connection, and then they could literally pull their own weight by adding to the wheels being driven. And if every four-wheel trailer added four more motors, this land train concept would be almost impossible to stop. But to tackle the Arctic Circle, LeTourneau knew that his VC12 would need to be revised. The new land train would need more ground clearance, better cold weather performance, and it would need to haul over 140 tons. In less than 1 month, LeTourneau had completed his new and improved land train. The VC22 Snow Freighter sported five trailers, each with the same hub-mounted motors for a total of 24 drive wheels. The electric motors generated electricity from two onboard generators, each powered by 400 horsepower Cummins diesel engines. And this bad boy ran a wheel and tire combo over 7 feet in diameter that acted as both a Jeep owner's wet dream and the vehicle's suspension. The reason LeTourneau was able to build the VC22 so quickly was that he based the construction off existing 6x6 vehicles his company had made. That meant also, in theory, the VC22 would be easier to repair in the field than the VC12. The 274-foot-long massive metal and engineering set out in the fall of 1954 to make the 400-mile journey from Fairbanks, Alaska to the Arctic Circle. En route, the snow freighter contended with massive snowdrifts, 4-foot-deep streams, and minus 68-degree weather. The land train could traverse any terrain that the Great White North could throw at it. In fact, the only issue that befell this overland behemoth was, of course, human error. While it completed its first season without incident, at some point during the second season of work on the Dew Line, the snow freighter's crew was trying to negotiate a steep grade when they managed to jackknife the land train. In the ensuing turmoil, a fire started in the front cab and destroyed the engines. The snow freighter was deemed inoperable, and while the LeTourneau Technologies could have repaired it, the massive land train was too deep in the Yukon wilderness. But Tradcom wanted more. Before the VC22 was even delivered, Tradcom ordered another land train from LeTourneau. The LCC1 was a shorter 16-wheel drive variant, but it sported massive 10-foot-tall tires. While the LCC1 had a lesser hauling capacity of only 45 tons, it had many functionality improvements over the snow freighter. The control cab was articulated for better maneuverability, and it was heated, which is important for driver comfort. The LCC1 also had a crane on the back, which was good for loading cargo and also for helping to change one of the vehicle's 10-foot-tall tires. In 1956, the LCC1 was dispatched to Greenland and stayed in operation in the region until 1962, helping to complete the easternmost part of the Dew Line. It was eventually rendered obsolete, but not before LeTourneau took one last crack at building the ultimate land train. And this is the result. The TC-497 was the longest LeTourneau train, with a ridiculous 54 drive wheels across 570 feet of cargo cars, fuel cars, and the 6x6 forward control cab. The cab was raised for better visibility and included sleeping quarters for six and a galley. Like the trains before it, the electric motors were mounted inside each wheel hub, but this time the power came from four gas turbine engines making over 1,000 horsepower each. The TC-497 also improved on previous land trains by adding steerable wheels to each trailer. The design was pretty ingenious. Using a rudimentary computer, each trailer could detect when it passed the spot where the control cars turned its wheels to match the steering and input timing perfectly. This is the kind of technological innovation that still impresses today. So despite being nearly the length of two football fields, the TC-497 actually had a turning radius similar to an 18-wheeler. While it topped out at about 20 miles an hour, the TC-497 could haul 150 tons up to 400 miles before needing to refuel. And that's assuming they didn't have a fuel car attached. But the Army had thought of that too, and actually planned to build a nuclear-powered version with an onboard reactor that in turn could be used to generate hydrogen for a fleet of fuel cell-powered construction or combat vehicles. But then again, this was the 60s, Everything had a nuclear-powered version under development.
Telling me that this sucker is nuclear?
And ultimately, the atomic land train never came to fruition. By 1962, the TC-497 had been delivered to a proving ground in Arizona and was outperforming any previous land-based mass transport vehicle. LeTourneau had done it, solving an intractable problem simply by building a bigger machine. It was an incredible expression of a very 1950s and 60s ethos that human progress could not be stopped, and anything standing in the way could be overcome with more. More technology, more innovation, more ingenuity, more American might. There may be no greater example from this era than LeTourneau's land trains as a highly complex and forward-looking solution to a very specific and temporary problem. Never before or since have our tax dollars gone towards building out one man's mechanical vision like this. Ultimately, the land train's singular nature would be their downfall. The same year the TC-497 was wowing officials in the Arizona desert, Sikorsky Aircraft performed the first test flight of an experimental heavy-lift helicopter called the S-64 Sky Crane. As that entered production, the overland train was no longer the only way to transport material in and out of the wilderness. After all, progress doesn't stop. Just because LeTourneau's machines were useful a decade ago didn't mean they would be in the future. Funding for the TC-497 was quickly pulled, and the era of the US Army's earth-shaking off-road land trains was over in the span of just 8 years. But what happened to them? The VC-12 was cannibalized for parts and today only exists in photos. The VC-22 snow freighter was eventually towed from its crash site and brought back to Alaska, and then promptly abandoned on the side of the road where it still sits today. I'm not joking. See for yourself on Google Street View. Progress waits for no one. After its service in Greenland, the LCC-1 passed through a few owners before ending up on display at the Yukon Transportation Museum in Whitehorse. But its influence didn't end there. Some of its trailers ended up at a scrapyard outside Seattle, where a man named Bob Chandler bought 4 of the wheels and tires to attach to a monster truck prototype he was building called Bigfoot. So I guess LeTourneau also indirectly helped invent Monster Jam. Likewise, the control car for the TC-497 is on display at the US Military Proving Grounds in Yuma, Arizona, where it gave the world a glimpse of an alternate future over 60 years ago. When R.G. LeTourneau died in 1970, the prolific inventor held over 300 patents to his name. And while his land trains never became the next big thing, even today, you can't help but feel a sense of awe and wonder watching videos of them in action. Maybe it's because it feels like that spirit of innovation is just missing today. The land trains are a tangible representation of an era where problems were solved in the most direct way possible. Today, efficiency is the goal. And while that does drive its own kind of innovation, it doesn't lead to inventing things like land trains. We've been digging through automotive history to find these stories for you, and we've got more coming in a few weeks. But I want to know, if you've got one that you'd like to hear us talk about, leave a comment, email us, shout into the void, send a carrier pigeon. Let us know so that we can share it with everyone. That's all for me. I'll see you in 2 weeks. Thanks for watching.